Okay, good morning, everyone. Welcome to the closing day of the program. So the first talk today will be by Dupe. He will tell us about the mirror of BAA brains.
Thank you very much for the introduction and for the invitation to participate in this very interesting program. It has been really fun experience for me, and I'm really glad that I came. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about mirror symmetry. Of BAA brains. The advantage of speaking on the last day is that even for this weird title, there's no need for explanation. But still, let me, for pedagogical reason, start slowly by reminding me a little bit about first, what is mirror symmetry? What are BAA brains? And in particular, what is a BAA brain? So mirror symmetry is a subject with a very long history. Well, let me first remove some reference. So mirror symmetry was first discussed or discovered in the context of string compactification. So it was discovered in the 80s by physicists by trying to answer the following problem. We know that we live in our world, which has four space-time dimensions. And at that time, people know that there's a very fancy theory known as string theory. And there's a very natural question to ask, how to go from the 10-dimensional string theory. At that time, string theory still lived in dimension 10 to the theory of our real world. And people start by considering compactification on Calabi-Yau threefold. And they have six real space-time dimensions. What people discovered is that if you just know your theory in the real world, then there are different possibilities to get the theory for the real world from string compactification. You can use a Calabi-Yau manifold X, or you can use another Calabi-Yau manifold Y. And as a poor little guy living in four dimensions, it's very hard to tell what is the correct Calabi-Yau that you should be using. There seems to be a symmetry. But this setup is not so well-suited to really study mirror symmetry. To study mirror symmetry, it's a good idea to consider how strings see this problem. And strings are like this in space. And if we add also time direction, it will sweep out a two-dimensional world sheet. So it's very natural to consider mirror symmetry as a duality of two D equals two quantum field theories. So if you consider a sigma model onto your Calabi-Yau space X, you may get a quantum field theory that depends on X. And if you consider a sigma model with the target being another Calabi-Yau manifold Y, you get another quantum field theory. And the statement of mu symmetry is that they are not really different quantum field theories. They're the same quantum field theory, but presented in different way. But as we all know, quantum field theories are complicated objects, and they are hard to study. To simplify the problem, Witten introduced topological twist to the game. So, starting from two non-trivial quantum field theory, Witten considered topological twist, and he discovered that there are at least two different twists. The first is what he called the A twist, which would give rise to the A model to X. And this topological twist forgets some information. It forgets more or less about all the complex geometry information of X. And it remembers the synthetic geometry. And you can also do a different twist, known as a B-twist. If you apply the B-twist, you end up with the B-model. And in the B-model, it cares about, instead, the complex geometry. Well, I'm considering two different twists to QFTX. And because the same quantum field theory has a different presentation, doing this topological twist for QFTX determines how you should twist QFTY. It turns out that this duality works in a way that if you do a twist to QFTX, you are forced to do B-twist to QFTY. So you end up with the B-model to Y, which cares about the complex geometry of Y. And on the other hand, if you want to do B-twist to QFTX, you are equivalently doing the A-twist to QFTY. You end up with A-model to Y, which cares about synthetic geometry of Y. Then you see that mu symmetry is about relating synthetic geometry of X on one side with complex geometry of Y on the other side, and vice versa. And you have a very sharp statement if you consider boundary conditions in this topological 2D sigma models. Boundary conditions in 2D quantum field theory form categories. So on one side, you should have the category of A-brains. And these are boundary conditions. In a model to X. And if the two quantum field theory are really the same, you have to conclude that whatever this is, this category has to be equivalent to the category of B brains on Y, which is the category of boundary conditions of B model to Y. And for such boundary condition, it is usually called a B brain on Y. And well, derived objects are also boundary conditions. So at this level, I don't need to add the word derived. They will turn out to be derived categories in supersymmetric quantum field theory. So, and this correspondence on the second line over here also tells you that if you instead consider B model to X, the category of boundary condition, or the category of B brains, will be equivalent to the category of A brains on Y. And this is perhaps the best way to derive this homological mirror symmetry, first formulated by Concevich without any help from physicists. So if you look at a typical object in the category of A brains, you see that this category at least contains objects that looks like the Lagrangian submanifold. With probably flat unitary, a flat bundle with unitary connection. On the other side, if you look at the category B brains, you see that it should contain at least objects that looks like homomorphic vector bundles over complex submanifold. And then you may be able to quickly guess that the category of B brain should more or less be the derived category of coherent sheaf on Y. And it becomes a little bit tricky on the other side, as Satoshi reminded us yesterday. So the category of A brains should contain at least the derived category, but it may contain some actual object. So you're saying that in all known cases, it's enough to consider derived chi category? Yeah, on generic Calabi-Yau threefolds that are simply connected, you don't have anything actual. But if you wish to really push the boundary of mirror symmetry to more general situations, you have to consider not only the canonical quasitropic brains that Sasi mentioned and other quasitropic brains. And I could imagine there can be more interesting objects in the A category. Oh, yeah, so the mirror of objects in the derived chi category, suitably defined, should be coherent sheaves on the other side. On generic Calabi-Yau threefolds that are simply connected, the observation is that you don't need this enlargement. On generic points on the model space. So if you, for example, take products of two elliptic curves, then for generic value of tau and tau prime, it's okay to just work with the derived chi category. For special value of tau and tau prime, it's no longer enough. There are actual quasitropic brains that can arise. Special means, in this case, probably special means tau equals tau to tau prime. Well, in some cases, we know that elliptically fibered Calabi-Yau are somewhat special. If your K3, for example, become elliptic fibered on special points on the model space, there's a possibility that there are actual B-brains. You can write down the condition for existence of quasitropic brains. But solving for the existence of such brain is a hard problem. More questions. So as you see, the presentation is really elementary. So please feel free to ask. Well, so we will consider examples that are in even dimensions. In fact, all our examples will be Hessian model spaces. And then you will see what's the meaning of this exchanging A and B. So please. No. At the level of quantum field theory, you always exchange the A twists and B twists. So there is no dependence on the dimension of the target space. This can be formulated abstractly at level of 2D quantum field theory. But you are very right that in even dimensions, especially for hypercurly manifolds, something special happens. And I will maybe try to explain shortly. Yes. So I think the simple example is in this example, and it's given by the paper in Kapusin and Olof. So currently, there is no really satisfactory definition of the category A brains. So, and I think that's one problem about the current formulation of mirror symmetry. So on this side, you can say that objects are all modules. On the other side, you cannot say the same unless you are willing to say objects are deformation quantization modules. And I don't know whether it is correct if one just include all deformation quantization modules. And if that statement is correct, then you have a better formulation of mirror symmetry. Okay, more questions? So one of the problem about this homological mirror symmetry is that it really doesn't tell you how to go from A brain on one side to B brain on the other side. It even won't tell you how to go from a space X to another space Y. But fortunately, we have another formulation of mirror symmetry known as the XYZ mirror symmetry, or mirror symmetry as T-duality. Probably in 96. And XYZ argued that if your Calabi-Yau can be viewed as a total space of vibration of special Lagrangian toroid, then you can try to do the following. You can consider the fiber-wise T-duality. And the conjecture is that after this procedure, taking into account properly the singular fibers, you will go from your Calabi-Yau manifold X to your Calabi-Yau manifold Y. And in even dimensions, and for hyperkähler manifolds, this become even nicer. So if X is hyperkähler, and the vibration is holomorphic in one of the compact structures, the fibers are abelian varieties, or generic fibers will be abelian varieties. And you can consider really doing relative Fourier Machai. This wave on a singular fiber should give you an equivalence of an equivalence between the derived category of coherent sheaf on X with the derived category of coherent sheaf on Y. And this is a little bit like the categorical formulation of mirror symmetry. except that on both sides you have B brains. So if you take a Cohen sheaf on one side, Friedman-Kai will give you another Cohen sheaf. So you go from B brain to another B brain. And this is not exactly what you, it seems that it's not exactly what you are after. But if X is hyperkähler, there are different complex structures and synthetic structures to consider this brain being A or B. So we will have three linearly independent complex structures and three Kähler forms. And you can consider a brain being A or B in each of the three columns. And you can consider brains of really special type. For example, you may want to consider brain of the type AAA. But unfortunately, that won't exist. Because roughly, A times A equals B. So if you have two A's, you see that at the third slot, you are forced to have B. And similarly, you can have brains of type ABA and BAA. And if you have brain that is of type B in complex structure NK, then at the third position, you are again forced to have the letter B. Roughly, B times B equals B. Or, well, this simply follows from the fact that K is just a product of NJ. And if you consider brains that are B brains in complex structure I, you can still consider BAA brains. If you forget about complex structure I and work in some combination of omega j and omega k, these will be interesting A brains that you may want to study. And then they'll be mapped to BBB brains. So the support has to be basically hyperkähler submanifold, but there can still be sheaf over that. So a BBB brain would be a hyperholomorphic sheaf supported on hyperkähler subspaces. Hyperholomorphic sheaf means they are holomorphic in all of the complex structures. Sorry, could you say again? So you expect that brains of a definite type form a full subcategory of the category of all brains. Anyway, so mirror symmetry will exchange these two, and acting on AAA brains or ABA brains, you will map a brain of a type to a brain of the same type. But today we will be focusing on BA brains and BBB brains. Because they are B brains in complex structure I, we can use Fourier-McKay type of argument to in that case, it has to be at the point or the whole space. Yeah. So today we'll consider the case that X is really the modular space of Higgs bundle. On a Riemann surface sigma. So my notation is that GC for now is a general complex reductive V group or algebraic. This is general. This depends on the Twister parameter. So in Kopfstein-Witten's story, to get this, you have to set their T parameter to zero. So that's known as the semi-classical or the classical limit, where mirror symmetry becomes Fourier-McKay transformation. For other values, you will have some different kind of relation. Yes. For holomorphic in I. You can always rotate such that it's holomorphic in I. And sigma will be a Riemann surface. With genus larger or equal than 2. So a prototypical example of GL and C. And I will use G to denote the compact form of GC. Yes. You mean here? So you expect the category of the AA brain to be a full subcategory of Dirac Cauchy sheaf on X, if X is hyperkähler. For each, So we will later see examples. So probably then you will be clear. Okay, so by now we should be all very familiar with this modular space. But still, let me remind you of several facts. First is that this space is Heber Kaler. And you will have maybe some singularities. Which are not present if you consider the model space of stable G Higgs bundles. Today we will deal with singularity by going to the stack. So I won't be terribly concerned about stability conditions. Maybe one more word on the Heber-Kaler structure. So as Satoshi mentioned, complex structure I and Kaler form omega I comes from or is conceptually related to the Kaler structure on your Riemann surface sigma. And omega j and complex structure j conceptually comes from the Kaler structure of GC, which is as a Kaler manifold T star of G. And again, K equals to item J. So here you see that in order to get a BAA brain, you will do something that preserve the compact structure on the Riemann surface, but do something funny with the compact structure or Kaler structure on GC. So another fact about Hessian model space is that it has a lot of BAA brains. It's very easy to do something funny for GC. For example, you have the Higgs vibration. Where generic fibers are complex Lagrangian abelian varieties. And over the discriminant locus, you will have some degeneration of your abelian varieties. And over the Neapolitan cone, you will have the worst singular fiber. And because Hessian vibration is, in a sense, picking a compact part of G and viewing them differently, so the result, the fibers of Hessian vibrations are all BAA brains. This is also what we have seen yesterday. And this includes all the fibers. In particular, it includes the Neapolitan cone. So for us, Neapolitan N are also BAA, or actually all components of the Neapolitan cone are going to be BAA. Here I don't want to add puncture. Maybe you can still add puncture and consider this story, but this is not what we haven't done that yet. And the Hessian base does not live in the total space of the Hessian model space, but it has the canonical section by picking all the origins of the varieties. This is sometimes called the Hitchens action. And this action is also BAA. So if you have never seriously considered BAA brains, but you have worked on Hitchens model space, you have been with BAA brains for most of the times. And in fact, you can consider generic situations between these two special limits. Namely, if you pick a real form GR of GC, yeah, any real form. So the compact form is what I denote as G. So GR is a more general real form. And then the modular space of GR Higgs bundles will also, so this is viewed as a subspace inside the model space of GC Higgs bundles. This is also a BAA brain. Because again, you are doing something funny over here. You are picking a Lagrangian submanifold of T star of G and force you to have Lagrangian brains in compact structure, well, synthetic structure omega j. And in fact, if you take, let me write it on the other. Well, let me use this space over here. So, an obvious real form is a compact real form of GC. And if you choose GR to be G, then you will get a component of Neoplan cone. This is what Satoshi would like to call bond GC inside the Neoplan cone. And if you, probably it's a bad idea to write here, but Oh, Wi-Fi details. Well, probably it's not too late for Wi-Fi password. Yeah, let me continue here. And another special choice of the real form is the split real form. This basically means having as many possible non-compact directions in your real group as possible. And then if you take GR to be the split real form, Nigel Hitchens has shown that for this modular space of GR Higgs bundles, it has a component being the Hitchens action. So if you consider more general your forms, you get even more interesting BAA brains. So another remark, the third remark, let me really start from over here. away from this discriminant locus, which I would denote as D. SYZ mu symmetry works. What do I mean by this? So you expect that away from this discriminant locus, you can really do relative Fourier Mackay. And you can get really an equivalence of the Dirac category of coherent sheaf on the modular space of Higgs bundles with the Dirac category of coherent sheaf on the modular space of Higgs bundle with G-check. Well, I probably need to add C everywhere. And G-check will be the Langevin-Dew group of G, as you know very well. And away from the discriminant locus, this equivalence is a theorem of Donaghy and Pentov. So this tells us that if you start with a BAA brain, a concrete way to get a BBB brain is to do the following. Step one, you first look away from the discriminant locus and then perform relative Fourier Mackay. And step two, try to extend your answer over the discriminant locus. And step three, rather prove or test your conjecture. So the first step can be done non-ambiguously if you know how to do Fourier Mackay. But there's a problem with step two, because the extension over the discriminant locus may not be unique. And there may be information that you cannot see on genetic fiber that are present over the singular fibers. So what you really want for step three is some powerful technique that can detect details of the brain over the Neapolitan cone. So you really want a tool that knows about singular fibers, or even better, the most singular fiber, which is the Neapolitan cone. So what would be such a tool? We know that the topology of the Hessian modular space all comes from the Neapolitan cone. So this tells us that it might be a good idea to consider a test in K-theory. Because the K-theory class are trivial, or a K-theory class are non-trivial because of there are interesting topology over the space. So if your B brain carries a non-trivial topological class, it has to be the case that it's behaving non-trivially over the Neapolitan cone. And a standard way to get the K-theory class or to detect the K-theory class is to compute index. So, if you have a proposal or someone gave you a proposal between two brains, type BBB and another of type BAA, you can immediately ask whether the following two index are the same. These are all B brains in compact structure I. So this is just the standard index or the standard Euler characteristic of sheaf cohomology. So there are some obvious problems about this proposal. First, again, it's about singularity. So you may want to write this index as a topological index given by some integral over the model space of Higgs bundles. But then you have to deal with the singularity of the model space of Higgs bundles. Another problem is that this space is non-compact. And this index written in this naive way may not be well defined. Third problem is that this kind of test seems to be just about two numbers. If you have two on the on one side, and you have two on the other side, and 2 plus 2 is not so powerful a test. These are possible problems. But there are solutions. By singularity, you can, as I mentioned, perform the computation on the model stack. And the solution to 2 and 3 are actually the same. Instead of considering usual index, you consider the equivariant index. What's the meaning of this? The Hessian model space has a natural C-star action known as the Hessian action. It comes from the scaling of your Higgs field. And what is good about this action is that all fixed points are in the Neapolitan cone. So in particular, the fixed point sets are actually compact. So your index may not be well defined, but your equivariant index should be well defined. So that solves the non-compactness problem. And what is an equivariant index? Equivariant index is not a single number. It will be a power series in your equivariant parameter with integer coefficient. So there are, if you have equality of equivariant index, you are having actually infinite many equalities. So it is going to be a really strong test. Any questions so far? Yeah. In some cases, combined with Fourier Pi and the knowledge of K3 class, the brain is almost fixed entirely. So the ambiguity you have in this Fourier Pi analysis is about more or less this K3 class. And if you can pin that down, you will almost fix the brain. And also this, if you have some proposal that works for all genus and maybe all groups, you can do this for all genus of the Riemann surface, all groups. And it will again be a very strong test. So, today, we will consider a particular proposal and try to test this proposal using a similar method. The proposal is due to Nigel Hitchin. It's about the case that GC is GL2C, and GR is U1,1. And we will consider the moduli space of degree zero rank two bundles. So here I will always assume implicitly that this GL2 Higgs bundle has degree zero. And inside there will be Higgs bundles that come from U1,1 Higgs bundles. So they are of the following form. So a Hitchin pair is a rank two bundle with a Higgs field. When it becomes a U1,1 Higgs bundle, the rank two bundle will split as direct sum of two line bundles. And the Higgs field will now be captured by phi 1 and phi 2. They are assembled into off-diagonal matrix. That send M1 plus M2 to M1 plus M2 times the canonical bundle of sigma. And one thing that you immediately see is that there are connected components of this U1,1 moduli space. Because here, you can have non-trivial degrees to this two line bundles. We'll assume that degree of M1 is negative. Sorry, degree of M2 is negative, and which has to be equal to the minus of the degree of M1. And we will introduce an integer I. And the degree of M1 will be G minus 1 minus I. what are possible values of I? From the definition, I has to be smaller or equal than G minus 1, by assumption. And if you look at the stability condition, you will quickly figure out that I has to be positive. Because here, the degree of M2 is negative. To have the Higgs field being stable, phi 1 must be non-zero. But if the degree of M2 is too large, there are no chance for, I mean, that when the absolute value is too large, there's no chance for phi 1 to be non-zero. So there will be G kinetic components of the modulus space of U1, 1 Higgs bundle inside this modulus space. And a remark is that all of these are in the smooth part of the bigger modulus space. And the last one contains singularity. So what would be the mirror of these brains? So you can first try to guess what would be the support of the mirror. The mirror would be some BBB brains. The support has to be hyperkähler. And you see here that the Higgs field are traceless. So if you do relative free Mackay on the other side, you should still have traceless Higgs field. Then it seems that it has to be the case that the mirrors are supported on the SL2, the modulus space of SL2 Higgs bundles. Notice here that I'm using the fact that GL2 is longer than due to itself. So the mirror of these brains will be sitting in the same space. So they are all sitting in the GL2 modulus space. And about the mirror, Nigel Kitchen as a proposal. His proposal is the following. Mirror of Li is given by lambda I, that is given by the following formula. This will be something that I call V, and lambda I will be the two I's extra power of V. So now I need to tell you what's the meaning of this expression. So V is supposed to be a hyperholomorphic sheaf on the modulus space of SL2 Higgs bundles. And E and capital E, capital phi, will be the universal Higgs bundle over the the model space of SL2 Higgs bundles times Riemann surface. So this model space parametrizes Higgs bundles, and one can form this universal family. And pi over here will be the map of this onto the first factor. And you take the derived push forward of this complex given by the universal Higgs bundle, and you end up with another complex on this space. So, couple of remarks. This V can be viewed as a hypercohomology complex. And I have shifted such that H1 has degree zero. And the interesting phenomenon observed by Thomas Hausl in his thesis is that on the stable loci, H0 and H2 are all zero. And so we'll have V being a hyperholomorphic rank 4G minus 4 vector bundle. No, they intersect at the intersection are complicated. It contains less at least the 2i symmetric power of your Riemann surface. And it's not as simple as that. Otherwise, you cannot detect information about these frames at the Neapolitan cone, right? If the intersection is just points. So I didn't explain why this is hyperholomorphic, but this is what is proved in Thomas Hausl's thesis. And another remark is that this V does not actually live on the model space, because it won't descend due to some obstruction of some Z2-gerb. But if you take the 2i's exterior power, there's obstruction. And they will be actually vector bundles. The stable part of the SL2 model space. So this is a very nice type of vector bundle that can serve as candidate for the mirror of such frames. And the mirror of L0 will be the zero exterior power, which is just the structure sheaf, a few more minutes, of the model space of S2 Higgs bundle. And as I remarked before, the L and the lambda actually live on the same space. so we form a stronger test. By considering the C star equivalent index if you look at this equivalent index of Li tensor omega tensor lambda j, and if mu symmetry works, you would expect this to be the same as the C star equivalent index of Lj tensor lambda I. And this is the commutation that we did. So there are three different possibilities about this question mark. The first possibility is that actual equality holds, and everyone will be happy. Another possibility is that the equality won't hold, but it holds after a small modification. And the third possibility would be that the equality won't hold. So we did this commutation with Thomas Hausl, Anton Melit, and we found that if you do a small modification of Nigel Hitchings' proposal, then this equivalent index is actually symmetric. So for each n j, you'll have a very complicated power series in T. And you'll see that it's actually symmetric in n j in a very non-obvious way. Here, I didn't include the g minus 1 because there are singularities. So Li is a line bundle tensored with Li. So let me make a remark about this. After finishing the remark about g minus 1. So for g minus 1, you need some small modification because you cannot do the computation over the space. You need to do the computation over the stack. And there are also three different ways to modify. You can first consider adding contributions of semi-stable Higgs bundles. Because the singularity, the mode space comes from strictly semi-stable Higgs bundles. Another possibility that is slightly wild is to also add contribution from unstable Higgs bundles. It's a little bit funny because the stack, I don't know what is a BA brain. So somehow, if you add contribution from unstable Higgs bundles, it's indicating that this brain extends to the also the unstable loci. And that's a little bit funny. And the third possibility is that So even in this range, there can also be unstable Higgs bundles. And if you are, yeah, if you are away from this, you are guaranteed to have, well, I mean, if I is more than zero, you can only be unstable. But by incorporating unstable Higgs bundles, I mean, adding all the contribution of unstable Higgs bundle onto L G minus one, or curly L G minus one. Third possibility is obviously that none of them work. So it turns out that somehow, indeed, you need to add the contribution from all unstable Higgs bundles and add that to the contribution of LG minus one. And well, what happened is that for contribution from the other unstable Higgs bundles, you all add that to LG minus one. That's the only way for this to work. And this is, well, it's a little bit subtle issue. This is saying that the way that we define this V, we define this vector bundle over the model space. But there may be other definitions of V over the model stack such that it becomes the same vector bundle. So two is true more or less because, in a sense, we are not using the correct extension of V over the model stack. Ideally, you want to find a version of V that gives vanishing contribution from unstable Higgs bundles. And then that makes slightly better sense. Okay, I will end with a remark about what is this modification that we need. This has to do with some modification that you cannot see away from the discriminant locus. It's something that you can only see over the Newport cone. So this L will be a line bundle on the model space of GL2 Higgs bundles with non-abelian level two and abelian level zero. It turns out that after this modification, away from the discriminant locus, nothing happened. This modification is only visible if you look at the singular fibers. And these are subtleties that only this type of commutation can detect. This is something that you cannot see in step one. And this presents ambiguity in step two. And you can hope to fix this by performing this kind of test. And since I'm already over time, let me end here. Thank you.
Questions, maybe?
Yeah, they are all BAA. Even after tensing with this line bundle, okay. They are still BAA. Okay. And this lambda I are formed out of this hyperholomorphic sheaf, and they are all BBB. The support is inside SL2, which is a hypercurrent submanifold. So maybe let me make one last remark about this modification. So one way to see that this modification is necessary is to observe that lambda I are actually soft-dual in the derived category. So it's supported in some submanifold. So if you take the dual, you get a shift, the shift is the same as the co-dimension. And the LI that was originally conjectured does not have this property. If you take this, then this won't be itself again with the shift. But after this modification, it will actually become self-dual again, with again a shift, and like 4G plus 3. And this is another way to see that this modification is something that is absolutely needed.
Yeah, would it take too long to like give a numerical example maybe? How does the index look for one of the LI?
Well, the index is given by a very complicated integration formula. So, and it's a very non-trivial step to show that these are actually symmetric. You need to find a very clever change of variable. Otherwise, you can just have this in Mathematica. But we found this change of variable, and this is proved in full generality for NJ.
Any other hands? So let's thank two again. Okay.